is going to end up.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm just thinking back to some of those critical moments of the split. You know, you had Scott returning to UQ on the cane, just completely running everyone over. Zornos starting off the, I believe it was week two, actually, when he pulled out the Volibear top and just won the game based off of that. Some of the sets we've seen, including, I believe, one Simpmaster sets, actually just like completely 1v3ing at times. Like, there's been so many fun moments. I mean, even the Vegan Bandit pulling out the Janna and absolutely carrying on the Janna. Like, it's been so much fun. And to see the regular season ending right now, a little part of me is sad, but I'm even more sad to see that Evelynn ban away. That's been Udisoft's go-to these past couple games on that Evelynn. He has been looking nigh unstoppable on it. The other pick that he's liked has been the Zac. However, it will be a Diana ban.
You know, there is always still the option of the Elise if he wants to go for one of those heavy AP burst assassins, but pretty much both. It's good to see both teams banning out comfort picks, you know, banning out the set for Simpmaster, banning out the Evelynn for Udisoft, as we get the Nautilus ban for Ducky. You know, it makes sense, although Ducky didn't have the greatest game on Nautilus, and mostly those dredge lines were into his death.
he hit them, though.
Nautilus, he hit them. He was very good at hitting. And Nautilus ulti and everything that he provides is just so impactful that you have to respect it.
Oof, the Zac was left up as the Kaylin actually getting banned away from one Thomas Shen's, or sorry, Kaylin being banned away from one Nightmare. Gragas was the one banned away from Udisoft. Gragas, one of the strongest junglers right now. I do believe you get one of the top tier junglers on that Gragas, bad things happen because they will make the Predator work to the utmost advantage. Murdoch with that priority pick, do they go for the Starving Senna? It looks to be the case, and something is breaking here. Either the undefeated streak of Usid or the undefeated streak of the Starving Senna. Wukong taken in return, and if that's Zornos on Wukong, I am scared for Murdoch.
Oh yeah, that's, we've seen three Wukongs today if this is on Zoranus, and they have been scary in all of them. And this is a big game because, like you said, either Usid's 100 win loss ratio is going away, or Senna's 100% win rate is also going away.
Yeah, I'm keen for this. This match just got twice as interesting as Rek'Sai is going to get locked in the jungler. We actually haven't seen too much Rek'Sai in a while. Usually once every couple weeks, Rek'Sai would come out very aggressive, very fast jungle. And okay, I think that's not going to get locked in. I don't see the need for two junglers. Could take war top. That'd be a surprise. Nasus would be a bold pick as well. Trying to go late against Usid, I'm not sure I'd recommend that line. That I don't see Nasus being locked in. And it is the Warwick. Okay.
You know, it somewhat makes sense. The E damage reduction and the fear against the Wukong dive is very strong. You know, he jumps on you, you pop that E. There's not much he can really do against that, as we have the Olaf picked for Usid.
Okay, so Usid has had some unconventional picks in the past. Usually they would be run by either Udisoft or they'd be run by Zoranos. Wukong and Olaf, I'd argue, are probably like the two strongest positions in their role right now. Those aren't funsy picks. Those are we want to destroy you picks. And I'm getting very concerned for Murdoch because we've seen Usid absolutely roll over teams when they're, you know, playing more comfort champions, maybe less meta. They're looking very meta right now.
Oh, yeah. Well, like we said, I think that Usid want to get that 7-0, and they do not want to give Murdoch a chance with even whether it be Senna, whether it be anything. They don't want to give them the chance to get that win off them. So they are going to go the best comp that they could possibly draft and just try and shut them down before they even get a chance to get going.
That could be the case right now. Murdoch, on the other hand, it kind of almost feels like, you know, they've sort of switched who's playing for who right now. We're still waiting to see. I'm still not convinced that Warwick actually isn't going bot lane to go with the Senna. I still could see that being the case as well. Starving Senna, Warwick lane, as you said. I would love to see that Pyke get locked in, but I do feel the Bard is probably going to be more likely for forward in this one, as we're going to hover it for now. I don't trust anything until it gets locked in. It could be a Rammus. I mean, why not? It's Usid. Anything can happen. But no, it will be the Bard instead. That will be going to forward. So a fun support. Actually, I kind of feel an underrated support in the current meta, and I'm good to see that one locked in.
Yeah, Bard, an incredibly strong champion, especially, you know, you can assume they're going to go Tahm Kench. You can assume they're going to go the Starving Senna. So the Bard Varus, very good pick up for the side of Usid. So this is going to be interesting to see whether or not Murdoch, with perfect starving center, is going to be able to take down Usyd.
Yeah, Ducky, again, one of the supports I kind of associate more with being hard engaged, actually playing like the heavy protector role in this Tom Kench. I'm going to be very curious in following sort of how Ducky approaches these fights and if he actually will stay back and help protect Nightmare or if he might find himself going a bit too deep. We will see when we get into this one. That will be a Victor locked in for Skippy. Victor kind of has actually underperformed as a champion so far in this tournament. I feel a lot more Victor losses as the A Soul Hover. I see you, Forward. I see you. I see what you're doing right there. I'm not going to be the most baited caster this time until that thing locks in. It's on you right now.
That would be a very interesting lock-in, and that's a bit more convention. But do we go convention? They are going to go convention.
I knew it. I knew he wasn't going to do it. I wanted it. I wanted it deep down, but I was not going to let myself get excited. You did not see the Jimmy legs happening underneath his desk. Maybe you saw that camera shake. But yeah. Shame. Shame no Aesol.
Shame, shame, shame. As it looks like we're... Yeah, there we go. They're switching around. Are they going to switch the... Yeah, there we go. We are going to have the Warwick in the top lane. So Warwick, again, I think, like we mentioned... The reason for that being that Wukong's engaged, you just insta-pop E, he gets a little bit of damage off on you, but you reduce it by a lot, and you just get the free fear, which you can then just chunk him down with. So, makes sense, as they are switching the Wukong Olaf quite a bit, so it's going to be interesting to see whether or not they do end up opting, I didn't see at the end there, whether or not they opt for the Wukong jungle. All the Olaf jungles. So
it was Olaf jungle, what I last saw.
They did? Okay.
Yep. I mean, I can just look up right now as I go, using my math and, oh no, all I see is a black screen. Okay, never mind, but I'm pretty sure it was the Olaf jungle Wukong top, so.
I assume so.
Oh, nope. No. No, that's not it at all.
Nope.
No, it's the, oh my gosh.
It's the Olaf top?
Yeah, Olaf's top? Take a guess who's jungle.
Victor? I don't even...
Well, no, Victor's on the other team.
Oh, that's right. Victor's on the... I don't even know.
Some casual Varus jungle.
How can you, Sid, build the most meta team comp?
No, it's not the case. It's not the case. I'm joking.
God, I was going to say. I was like, how do they build the most meta thing and then just go, hey, we're going to have some fun with it. I'm the most baited caster, apparently. So...
I'm actually surprised that worked. We're having fun here. It's been a long season. I gotta get one in. But no, it is the Olaf jungle, the Wukong top. We're not seeing Varus jungle, but what we are seeing are the champions loading onto the Rift. We're gonna be cutting to you real soon. One last time, it will be Murdoch on the blue side taking on Usyd on the red side. Usyd fighting to get that undefeated record. This is the most conventional team comp we have actually seen out of them so far in this tournament. And very, very shortly, I thought we were going to be jumping onto the Rift right now, but sort of wait a minute. It looks like we're going to be jumping abracadabra. Boom, there was a pause.
Oh, that was a pause. Okay, that is a-okay. It's good to know. So going into this, who do you think really won that pick and ban phase?
To be perfectly honest, I actually like Usyd's team comp. You got an Olaf and a Wukong on, probably two of the strongest performing players in this tournament. Those are two win more champions, yes, but all they've done is win. So I kind of feel like that combo is going to work together. I like the idea of throwing, the Olaf into the Warwick. I feel like Olaf is going to win that matchup. Similarly, in the jungle, it is Wukong jungle. My bad. It is Wukong jungle Olaf top. I had that wrong.
There we go. That's what I thought. I thought I saw it at the end. I was like, did they switch?
I was too concerned with trying to convince you Varus was jungling, man. I wasn't paying attention.
I was too busy being convinced it was jungle. So overall, I do like the... I really like the Usyd pick and ban. So my dilemma this game is the stats side of me loves the 100% win rate center, but also the 100% win rate Usyd. So, personally, I actually think that in terms of a 100% versus 100%, I think Usid is actually a stronger statistic. As, you know, that Sen has been piloted by a lot of different people in a lot of different ways. And yes, they've all come out on top. Usid's played a lot of different things, a lot of different ways, and they've always come out on top. So I'm still going with the Senna pick ban is being broken as we get into game.
Yeah, we are underway. As you can finally see the team comps, it is the Wukong jungle with the Olaf top. So a little bit of a mix-up right there. I don't think it's quite as spicy, though, as rocking that Warwick top. That's not something I was expecting to see. But again, Murdoch, technically, they are mathematically eliminated. So this is the time. If you want to play your sort of fun niche champion and your fun niche role, this is the game to do it. And you can see Killer Roots already having a bit of a blast right now. Just having a good old chuckle in the middle of the lane. Zoot as well going to be joining him, rocking that air guitar. It's a party on Summoner's Rift, and it's good to end with a party for sure.
Yeah, you know, it's good to that they're at least, you know, it's good to see that all the teams are still enjoying themselves, and they're not, they're taking themselves seriously, but they're also, you know, they know when to have a bit of fun.
Oh, well, I don't think Sinmaster's having a lot of fun right now. Udisoft definitely is, as they get that first blood. It's actually Zarnos who picks it up. Skippy in a lot of trouble. Help tries to arrive, and they do get one back on the Wukong jungle. Zarnos, though, is going to flash after Killaroo. The axe does not connect, but the chase is still on that axe, Will, and Killaroo is slowed by it. Just going to try and buy some time, but in the end, Will fall down. Zoot actually steals the kill away, saying, I did all the work. I deserve that. So 2-1 in Sydney's favor.
Well, that is what we call not what you want to see if you're Murdoch. You do not want Zoranus with a kill and Zoot with a kill at 1 minute. That is not what you like to see. They end up getting the kill onto Udisoft there, but the benefits that come out of that fight, they nearly got another kill there. That would have been absolutely massive. But, you know, Zoot was like, hey, I want a kill for my troubles.
Absolutely, and I think the big thing to take note of, though, is the flashes that had been used. Killaroo, Skippy, each of you has flashed on the Murdoch side, but for Sydney, only Zoot has used it, so no flashes in the mid lane. Could be interesting. However, Udisoft is a jungler who might take advantage of the fact that there is also no flash available on Killaroo on the Rex side. Zarno still doesn't have flash either, and it's actually taking a fair bit of time to get back into lane. It's going to go for the walk as opposed to the teleport, so Sipmaster might be able to get a bit of experience advantage in this situation. Everyone who wasn't really involved in that fight, well, those would be the members of the bot lane, as you can see right here. They're content to just farm away. I expect this to be actually a relatively passive bot lane, just because it is a starving Senna. You got that Tahm Kench, and, you know, Change of Corruption, Piercing Arrows, even Cosmic Bindings, anything really hits Nightmare, it's going to be pretty easy for Ducky to just swallow up and keep that Senna.
Yeah, so I think they're definitely going to, you know, the way that both teams are built is we're going to see a lot of poke. But until a gank comes down or a mistake is made, I don't think we're going to see many actual kills coming out of this bot lane. As, yeah, this, I really like the fact that Usid decided to switch the Wukong and Olaf around. As we have a potential gank coming in, well, we're actually just going to get a fight over crap.
Yeah, Killaroo wants no part of that. It's going to back away. And I'm, again, a similar complaint that I've kind of had with most teams that come up against Usid right now is they try to match with Udisoft and they try to sort of keep the jungle on the same side when really they should be focusing on that bot side. Like, yeah, starving Senna probably isn't the best in lane, but the lane is frozen in a good spot. And yeah, Killaroo is focusing more on that top side, trying to disrupt, you know, that same jungle top synergy that we've seen be successful time and time again. And that's a lot of times where Murdoch or like the teams that face Usid start to fall apart, because they're putting all their resources into the top side that's losing, and they're leaving Usid's bot lane, which always wins lane as well, to kind of struggle as well. So they wind up losing on all fronts, and things start to snowball. I want to see that change. I want to see Murdoch actually play the opposite end of the map against Usid, something I haven't seen a lot of teams do.
Yeah, it's a really, you want to see them capitalizing on their advantages. Skippy taking a lot of damage there in the mid lane, actually. You know, they get out safe enough, but getting chunked down for about half his HP there by Zoot.
Yeah, and having no flash on Zoot as well, it could also be an opening, one would think, for Murdoch as well to possibly attack that mid lane. Attack the bot half of the map. Instead, you know, Killaroo using the fast clear of Rek'Sai to kind of get some invading in, get some farming in. Now we're starting to really do the sort of top side, bot side, jungle mixed matching, but it did start a little too late. However, he is actually looking for a gank right now on the bot side of the map. Was able to jump onto forward, but in response, we are seeing the gank up top, and Sintmaster is already quite low. Udisoft is here, and that's going to be a kill going to the Monkey King in Udisoft.
Yeah, Udisoft picking up the kill that he wasn't able to get earlier in that top lane, and they're just going to go for plates. And right now, that was not great if you're Murdoch, because you committed Killer Robot's side and didn't get anything for it. Meanwhile, Udisoft made a successful gank in the top lane, got a kill, and is going to get some plates for his trouble. So, not great turns of events if you're Murdoch.
Yeah, I wish we could have seen what happened down below to really break down why the gank didn't work for Killer Roo. I liked the play. I think Murdoch did the right thing. It's just unfortunate that they weren't able to execute it correctly. But for a team that's, you know, growing, that's struggled in this season as well, I'd rather see situations like that than situations where they do the wrong thing and get doubly punished. So kudos to Murdoch for going for that play. Unfortunately, it doesn't work out. And on the opposite end of the map, it did work out. And all of a sudden, we're going to start seeing this snowball happen. Zornos, again, I've mentioned he hasn't lost lane yet. Well, we're about 6 minutes in. He already is nearly doubling Sintmaster's farm. This has been status quo for Usted game after game after game, and it is nothing against Sintmaster. He's been one of the stronger top laners. However, Zornos has arguably been my MVP pick, and he's already starting to show why in this one.
Yeah, and oh, wow, actually, the fight going on in the top lane. As in reality, like, you're talking about that snowball. Usted is already, like, closing in on 3k gold, 3k gold difference on Murdoch at 6 minutes. So they are starting to get that advantage, and most of that is coming in the form of the top lane, as you can see with the double CS pretty much. So yeah, it is not a great position if you are Murdoch already. You know, you got that kill, sure, but nothing's working out so far. And you know, they're doing the right idea, but I think, like you said, they've just got to not try and play Udisoft's game and just pretty much take the opposite. As, oh, Killer Roo, no.
No, see, it's not just the entranceways to your jungle, it's the entire top off of the jungle that tends to belong to Udisoft. Zoot stepping forward to try and punish as well. They're not going to be able to find the kill, but Killer Roo is forced out of the top half of the map. And what makes this one kind of scary was the fact that it was warded up. Like, there was vision covering those entrances, and yet Udisoft is able to find a way. Meanwhile, Forward doing a bit of roaming himself helps get the kill in the mid lane, so a good roam from the Bard, something you have to be cautious of, especially when you run the Starving Center lane, because it's one of those weaker lanes. It does open the door for those roaming supports. Bard being one of the best helps find the kill in the mid lane.
Yeah, and that's going to be really big for Zoot and Udisoft there, as, you know, that Zoot will take a little bit. Zoot will get some tower plating, and Udisoft will get a couple of hits in, maybe a little bit of gold for his trouble, and that's not what you want to see, as Udisoft actually getting jumped on a little bit, but, you know, he's safe. He knows what he's doing.
Yeah, he'll be fine for this one.
He'll
right now.
Is
you said continuing to push their advantages. The big scary one really is the stop lane right now. Zornos already about 30 CS up on the Warwick top. Again, was questioning the Warwick top, and I still am not saying I disagree with the pick entirely, but against Zornos on the Olaf, it is a bit scary. I do like how both top laners are actually running junglers in the top lane. I do appreciate that, so it's definitely an unconventional matchup. It makes it fun to watch, but it's definitely been going Zornos' way at this stage. No team has made a play for the dragon just yet. Usted, again, being one of those teams, if they do go for that first dragon, it's actually pretty late into the game, but at the moment, they do have Udisoft on the bot half of the map. You also have Forward starting to press down a bit, looking for some invades, and Forward actually might be getting caught right now. Has to use the ultimate in order to catch out Ducky, but still trying to buy time, still looking for a potential re-engage, because Udisoft is here. Nightmare is going to go ahead and retreat back underneath the tower, and I don't think Usid is going to push their luck.
No, they might try and get a little more invade damage, or, you know, maybe catch him out on the roam, like here.
Oh.
But overall, I don't think they're going to be able to get much out of it, as he's going to take that down. And I think that, yep, they're pinging Dragon, and I think they're going to try and make their way there.
Yeah, this is actually going to be one of the earlier Dragons for Usid so far throughout this tournament. You don't usually see Udisoft trying to make too many plays on the bot half of the map, but when he does, there is a greater objective in mind. That will be this Ocean Drake, and it will get secured by Usid after Killer Roo kind of got poked around and bullied a bit. However, no farm in his bot side jungle right now. He might try to make the play. It has been warded This would be a crazy one, though. It's a bit of a suicide mission, but he's going to do it. You can see where he's sitting. In he goes. Does not get the smite, however. Will go down, but the Abyssal Voyage just in the rest of Murdoch here. Coming up from above, though, is one dude, and he's able to get right into Nightmare's face. Ducky makes the swallow, buys some time. Nightmare on the run, and that leaves poor Killaroo alone in the pit, at least until he tries to tunnel off. But no, he actually went further in and does go down. So Killaroo, the one casualty on the steal attempt.
Udisoft's ulti locking down Murdoch inside of Zoot's W. They're stunning, I believe, two or three of them there. Was absolutely massive. And just unfortunate misplay by Ducky. If you watch, he eats Senna, which pushes the ultimate away from the fight. And means that the ulti hits no one. So at that point, you've just lost an ulti for pretty much nothing. And really unfortunate. Zoot going very hard there. And that was a very, very smart fight by Usid. You know, it makes sense why Killaroo would go for the steal, but I think they probably overcommitted a little bit for it.
I've never seen that interaction before.
Oh, it's fun.
I've never seen the interaction like be that dramatic and that impactful, I should say. You would have loved to see it go the other way, where Ducky had swallowed Nightmare and pulled him back to make sure it hits everyone, not pushing him forward so it misses everyone. So really unfortunate for the Murdoch side. It could have helped turn that fight around, but as it stands, they lose the dragon. They're actually losing Rift Herald as well right now, as Udisoft has already found himself there. And things going from bad to worse quite quickly. Already a 5k advantage, or just about, going Sydney's way. Again, that top lane, the bleeding has kind of slowed down. Only a 40 CS advantage, so it has slowed a bit. But other lanes are starting to accelerate a bit more for Sydney, as their gold generation is happening at a much quicker pace.
Yeah, and something to take note of as well is the summoner choices Murdoch has opted for. They've gone for a very aggressive set of summoner spells. They have the Ignite on Simp Master in the top lane. They have no TP on Skippy in the mid lane. So currently there is a 2-teleport advantage on the side of Usid that Murdoch just can't match.
Yeah, I mean, I like aggressive play, don't get me wrong, especially when you probably are the underdog, because I feel like going aggressive is usually the way to do it, but there is such thing as too much aggression, and Usid is a team that can look to punish it. Yeah, Rift Herald is going to be dropped, and we actually are going to have a fight. The Magical Journey for Forward is going to try and zone Nightmare out of it as the Cyclone holds up the front line. Zoot is able to find Killaroo in the midst of all of it, and that's one kill. The second Cyclone will help bring down Ducky, who won't be able to flash over the wall. Meanwhile, Forward, he's continuing to keep Nightmare zoned out of anything. Zoot deciding against that tower dive means only two kills go Sydney's way, but they get the tower as well.
Yeah, they get the tower, and they're probably going to get the extra smash off from Shelly here. So another half of this tower, they're probably going to get the bot tower, the tier 2 as well.
Yeah, they are going to do just that, as the second tower does fall with help of that Rift Herald. And this is that Sydney style. They get a lead, they get more of a lead, and then they do not look back. We are nearly at a 10k gold lead, less than 15 minutes into this game.
Yeah, no, it is rough, and they're about to lose a top tower mid in the next push, pretty much, as Zoranus, like I was going to say it earlier, if you want the definition of freezing a lane for an advantage, just watch what he was doing earlier, just standing there, freezing the minion wave in a point where Simp Master pretty much can't do anything, as we have another dive.
Yeah, another dive, this time from Zoot. He will be able to escape with use of the Chrono Break in that situation. Interesting play right there, and I want to talk about Murdoch real quick, because they haven't necessarily done anything inherently wrong. In fact, a lot of their motions, I feel, have been correct. Just Usid has either been that one step faster or just played the lanes, unfortunately, a bit better. And there's sometimes when Usid starts to feel themselves, there's just so few holes in their gameplay that even with Murdoch playing well, playing as strong as pretty much we've ever seen them, it looks like they're just getting rolled, because they are. And it's just a difference, unfortunately, I feel, in some of the skill of those players. As what an ultimate right there out of Forward, going to hold Simp Master in place. He's still going to be trying to hold the line, but won't find anything.
I want to see a replay of that again. I think, did Zoot E into the, or Chrono Break into, what even happened there, just into the ultimate to stop him from getting all the way out? Nearly was an incredibly good play from the side of Usid. Overall, still a very beneficial one from them, as they're just going to capitalize even more in this top lane.
Yeah, exactly. They're going to go ahead and push that advantage in the top side. Usid, they are aware of how ahead they are, and unfortunately for Murdoch, they just can't step up to challenge at this stage. Walking in would be to near certain doom, and unless you have a secured numbers advantage. But if you take a look at the war control on the top half of the map, it was all for you, Sid. So nowhere safe for Murdoch to approach. That's why you didn't see them try and force that 3v5 in that situation. Instead, they're going to keep trying to mitigate the damage, keep trying to clear. Technically, they have a bit of a scaling comp right now. And if Murdoch can somehow slow this pace down and find a way to get us another 15 minutes in this game, maybe they can find a way back. Instead, though, at the way how things are going, you said they just have complete control.
Yeah, they have complete control. As you watch, they're going to force them to either contest or take this dragon, as Zoranus is just running it down top lane into that Simpmaster who is going to die for his sins.
Oh so, my gosh.
Yeah, even with the center ulti coming through, there's nothing he can do, and they're forced away from that dragon, because if they didn't, they were just going to lose top. So, oh, and the Infernal Drake coming up. Oh no.
All right, Murdoch. Look, here's what you got to do, okay? This is some deep, deep, deep formal strats right here.
Yeah.
We are playing online. You got to, how should I, you know what? I'm actually gonna hold on to that thought, because there's a bit of a fight happening right now. Thank you for saving me from that thought process. The ultimate from forward actually stopped Zoot from getting the damage down. That said though, Sydney's still gonna hold their ground in that front line. On the backside, Killaru thought he could get to Thomas Shen, but Udyshoff was able to make the save. Zoot back in the front line as well, buys enough time, but can't quite find Nightmare. Still forward, and Zoot are still gonna look for this fight. Sinmaster actually getting a lot of damage down onto Zoot himself, who has to be careful, was ignited, but is still able to kite the poor Sinmaster to his doom. Forward now leading the charge, actually looking for that flash engage, doesn't connect with the Cosmic Biting, and eventually you said looks back off.
That is my favorite interaction I never knew existed. The Bard Tunnel and the Victor W. Most things when you get, you know, pulled out of CC in the Bard Tunnel pulls you out of it. The Victor one just freezes you in the tunnel. And you continue afterwards when you're done. I loved that. I didn't even know that was a thing. He does get the consolation kill onto forward there, but it's all too little too late at this point. Baron is not even up for another, like, 3 minutes. So they're just going to continue to just push this lane down.
Yeah, they're just going to not only push this lane down, but push any hopes of Murdoch running spoiler down as well. And what I think is really impressive about this victory right now from the Usid side, actually, is they've done this in a relatively bloodyless game. Like, compared to what we saw in our last game, this has been a lot more controlled, a lot less fights. And you said they've just done this out of pretty much lane strength and positioning and picking the right times to invade and sort of suffocate out Killaru and stopping him from having that impact. This is the definition of win lane, win game. And we haven't seen those crazy fights, really. We haven't seen anything too much like that. It's just we won our lane. We carried on. Like, the highest kill participation, 7 out of the 11 coming out of Zoot. That's actually surprisingly small, all things considered. So you said they just are playing like the stronger team today. And Sinmaster, he may have pushed a little too far up the lane. He's just going to get jumped upon by the entirety of the Usid side. Or is he staying alive with the help of Nightmare? And a good time to buy some time, but going golden perhaps a bit too prematurely, courtesy of one forward ultimate, does mean that the rest of Usid will catch up. But here comes Murdoch. They're turning it around. They actually find a kill onto Udyshoff, and they have Zoot in their eyes next. He's going to try and kite forward back to provide some support. But in the end, Usid do not find that re-engage, and Murdoch, they get away with one.
Yeah, that's that overcommit we might have seen a little bit of. But even then, even the slight overcommit, we could say, from Usid, they get the Herald for it. So the advantages they still get are probably going to be worth the death of Udyshoff. We saw Udyshoff both times has been willing to die for objectives to be taken or for kills to be had. So, you know, right now we have Zoranus.
Oh, Thomas. Wow. Thomas actually in a very risky spot right now, but it was all bait. The Cosmic Biting stops Skippy and Ducky from rejoining the fight, and Thomas just turns around and pops Nightmare. Oh, that said, the fight will continue. Caught in the choke point is one Murdoch side, and they're just going to go down. 1, 2, 3. Sinmaster, the last man left standing, is slowed by the Binding. Forward, still running forward. Zoot as well going to jump on this poor puppy who does get put down as Murdoch's hopes come to a crashing halt. The ace for Sydney, and we might see a Dancing Rift Herald at this stage.
We very may well see a Dancing Rift Herald, as Senna is the only one alive. You know, we're going to have two more coming up very soon, but I don't think it's going to be enough to stop the push. They're going to get two inhibs and the towers.
Oh, they're going to get game. Everything. This is looking like game. My attention is on Harold, still alive after slamming it, and with everyone stunned behind, we get the Dancing Rift Herald to end our regular season play as the University of Sydney take down Murdoch.